Hello, everybody. Welcome. I'm Jennifer LaRue. I'm the Director of Public Programs here at the Mark Twain House and Museum in Hartford, Connecticut. And I'm delighted to be here tonight with our guests, Barrett Swanson and Rachel Poser. We're going to have a fascinating conversation. I've had the honor of spending a little bit of time with them in a tech run and in the green room just now. And they are really lovely people and really smart and interesting, as we've come to expect from not only all of our speakers at the Mark Twain House, but particularly this Harper's series, of which this evening's program is part. So I'm not going to talk for too long because I know I'm not the main attraction tonight, but I do have a little bit of housekeeping to go over with you all. First of all, if you're not seeing this yet, but you're hearing me, please hit play to make sure that your crowdcast is actually beginning. And if you have tech issues, please let us know in the chat and we'll do our best to help you remedy those. Otherwise, just sit back and enjoy the talk, but do continue chatting. I love to see people chatting, and we've developed quite a community of audience participants who I think have made some connections over the past year and a half. So please do chat in the chat. However, if you do have a question for either Barrett or Rachel for the tail end of the program after they've spoken, please put your question in the area that says ask a question at the bottom of your screen. There's already one question there. You can also take a look at the questions that other people have posed, and if you have the same question, you can upvote it, and that kind of moves it up to the top of the stack. So again, if you have a question, rather than put it in the chat, please put it and ask a question. That makes that part of the program just that much easier for us. A couple more things I want you to know. First of all, that this is, as I said, part of a wonderful series, a partnership with Harper's Magazine that began earlier this year and has been just bringing really smart, wonderful writers to our screen to talk about writing and all kinds of social issues and just fascinating things. Really tickled to be part of that. One of the wonderful aspects of our relationship is that Harper's has made a very generous offer to registrants of our programs. You can subscribe to Harper's for only $16.97 for a year, and that's Harper's print and online, and you get access to the magazine's 170-year archive. So there's a link for that in your chat, and please take advantage. I did, and I am thrilled. I love getting my Harper's magazines, and really good reading, as you can imagine and maybe already know. And also know that Mark Twain was published in Harper's, and that's kind of one of the origins of this relationship. So we're thrilled to carry on that legacy through these wonderful talks. Also in the chat is an opportunity to purchase a signed copy of Lost in Summerland. And we know that you can go to other places and purchase this book for sure. But when you order through us, you get a signed copy, first of all. And also you get to know that your purchase is benefiting the Mark Twain House and Museum, which I'm going to talk about now. The Mark Twain House and Museum is a private nonprofit organization. We have, as our major source of revenue during normal times, our guided house tour, which we've been unable to offer through most of the past year. We are back in business again on a limited scale, but we have really had to work hard as a staff and board of trustees and our volunteers to keep ourselves afloat during the past year. So any donations that you are able to make, I want you to know are very deeply appreciated and put to very good use by the staff. And it's a very good time if you are able and willing to help us out in that regard. The Birdies for Charity program, part of the Travelers Golf Championship during this period, adds 15% to whatever you donate. So that stretches your donation dollars a little bit farther and helps us out just that much more. So please, if you are able, and we know not everybody is, if you are able to help us out, we appreciate that very deeply. I want to point out that tonight's program is produced in part with support honoring the legacy of Frank Lord, who is a beloved trustee of ours, and we're very honored and delighted to carry on his legacy through these programs. I'm going to introduce our guests now. So Rachel Poser is the deputy editor of Harper's Magazine. Her writing, which often focuses on the relationship between past and present, has appeared in Harper's, the New York Times, Mother Jones, and elsewhere. Barrett Swanson is a contributing editor, at Harper's Magazine. He is the recipient of a 2015 Pushcart Prize, and his short fiction and essays have been distinguished as notable in Best American Short Stories 2019, Best American Non-Required Reading, which I love, in 2014, Best American Essays in a number of years, Best American Sports Writing. His work has appeared in Harper's, The New Yorker, The Paris Review, The New York Times Magazine, Best American Travel Writing, Best American Travel Writing, 2018 and 2020, I should say. And if that doesn't give you a sense of the range and breadth of Barrett's writing, I don't know what will. So please, everyone, join me in welcoming to our screen and to tonight's conversation, Rachel Poser and Barrett Swanson.
Thank Welcome. You so much, Jennifer.
Thank you so much, Jennifer.
I'm going to sit back and relax and enjoy your conversation. And Rachel, will you let me know when it's time for me to come back on to help you with the Q&A?
Absolutely.
All right. Sounds great. Thank you. See you in a little bit.
Great. I'm so pleased to be here to celebrate Barrett and Lost in Summerland. I edited two of the stories, the essays in this collection for Harper's originally. Though, of course, the ones in the book are the director's cut where Barrett added in all the material that I had taken out. So totally his prerogative. But in any case, it was a real pleasure in reading the book to see how these individual assignments became a cohesive, beautiful whole, which becomes a kind of meditation, a post-religious quest, to borrow a phrase from the book, to find meaning in today's world. So I wanted to start there with the idea of these essays becoming a whole. At what point did you feel that these pieces could become a book, and what were some of the themes that started to emerge for you, the sort of guiding questions?
Yeah. Well, thanks, Rachel, for doing this. I'm really, really pleased and thrilled to be talking with you. And thank you to the Mark Twain House for hosting us. This is really amazing. I'm very, very honored to be here. The book, I guess it was pretty late in the process where I started to see some of these dormant themes kind of burbling to the surface. And it may have been not until, well, really like the Disaster City piece almost, where I felt like everything was coming together in a way that I didn't totally anticipate. I mean, the first essay in the book inaugurates what I hope are a lot of the most legible themes, and that having to do mostly with a personal crisis in my mid-20s where I was almost fatally depressed. And that really was the starting point for, I think, a lot of the sort of intellectual and emotional questions that I took up throughout the book and the various subcultures that I was exploring. Ended up, when looking back on them, I realized like, oh, I'm really trying to kind of carve out some sort of cogent reacquaintance with narrative, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I want to talk about, let's start at the beginning maybe, and talk a little bit about that first essay in which you and your wife travel to Florida for what should be a vacation, but then things start to fall apart. And it's an homage in a certain sense to Didion's The White Album, and has a similar motivating question about the breakdown of narrative. And I wanted to ask, sort of what for you were the early signs personally and culturally of that dissolution of meaning, and how did you think about answering those questions as you moved through the reporting?
Yeah. So the preoccupying headspace that I had at the time was something, a kind of critical lens that I was tutored in graduate school, something called the hermeneutics of suspicion, which is basically just like a critical framework for looking at a text and regarding it with a kind of mercilessness, really seeing as the text as not so much an offering, but a kind of manipulation. And so I was trained to see narrative in some sense as a form of agents, as a form of power, a kind of agent of power, an agent of manipulation. And so while that critical framework has much to recommend it, and while I deploy it pretty much all the time in all of these essays, that first essay is a record of how I began to take that critical lens, and it became sort of somewhat pathological, or I was turning it on myself, and I lost the sense of what should have meaning and what shouldn't have meaning, and really began to distrust narratives generally. And all around me, I began to see many swaths of the country or many different subcultures taking up these other narratives, whether it be, you know, something as banal as like CrossFit, like people sort of regarding exercise as this sort of religious practice, or whether it was techno-utopianism, you know, like the triumphant evangelistic tones of Silicon Valley, or whether it was conspiracy theories, people grasping for some sort of narrative as a kind of surrogate to some other way of constructing meaning in our lives. So in the kind of like the post-religious, like, age, or the even sort of the post-national age, this kind of general breakdown of narrative, creating all of these ancillary narratives or ancillary subcultures who were applying sort of religious fervor to these other aspects of their lives.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you do seem to wrestle with trying to rethink that approach to narrative, but also being so tutored in it that, you know, when you go to, in the book, you travel to a utopian experiment in Florida, you talk to people who believe that they can commune with the dead, including your own brother, you talk to a 9/11 conspiracy theorist, and you seem to be wrestling with the slippage between rational and irrational, but also just whether you can construct a narrative and whether that can work for you, and trying out all of these different, was the approach to sort of go find the margins and then work back towards something that felt more rational to you, or why seek out the sort of conspiracy theorist, the utopian?
Yeah, I mean, I, and this is where I think that it was a kind of post facto realization that the pieces are kind of coming together, right? Like, because in many cases they just emerged out of either some sort of personal irritation with some narrative that I found, you know, sort of voluptuously insufficient in the culture, or it would be something incidental, like with the techno-utopian piece. So I went to this place called the Venus Project, which is I think it's like a 20-acre compound in central Florida that was run by, the time when I went, he was 99 years old, a man named Jacques Fresco, who wanted to replace capitalism with a resource-based economy, and had built these enormous domes on this property that he had to serve as a kind of
I think Barrett has frozen. Jennifer, do we want to ask him to sign back in and come out?
Yes, Barrett, if you can hear us, and I'll type, okay. He knows the drill, he'll be back in a moment. So I'm sorry for the interruption. Sounds like he's got a crazy internet connection. So he'll be right back. But I can't wait for you to continue. This is absolutely fascinating.
thank you.
Well, Julia has pointed out that if you do subscribe to Harper's, you can read Barrett Swanson's viral sensation, The Anxiety of Influencers. And she's, oh, there you go. Hi.
Hi. I felt like an astronaut. Everyone was like, can you hear me? And I was like, well, space.
We like that. I'm going to disappear again. Sorry for the interruption.
In any case, I'm sure you will pick up the narrative right where you left it.
I can't remember. Where did I fall off talking about? So Jacques Fresco had this.
You just introduced the Venus Project.
Okay. And so basically, I was really, a student of mine had suggested that this was the leading social architect of the future, like 21st century's greatest contribution to social thought. And so this student had written it in an essay, and I, you know, just went and checked it out. And what often happens is that a kind of zany topic will present itself to me, and then kind of pulling back the onion layers, I begin to see that there's something else going on, or that it's intersecting with all these other interesting questions. And in the case with the Venus Project piece, it was that, you know, they were coming in under the banner of techno-utopianism and progressivism, but it, of course, all of the sort of utopian ideals were being harvested by things like Facebook. So at the Venus Project, while I visited, a man from Facebook was there and basically saying that the Facebook was trying to do a lot of the things that Jacques Fresco, this utopian, was talking about. And so I became interested in exploring the ways in which Silicon Valley often appropriates utopian narratives and uses it to basically perpetuate social inequities that are already existent. And that ends up being the MO with a lot of the pieces, this kind of, I don't know where the piece necessarily is gonna take me, but I just kind of trust the questions, or I guess I have a sort of intuitive trust in there must be a more interesting reason why I'm drawn to this than just zaniness or, you know, personal animosity or something like that.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned that the origins of the book came, or at least the origins of the questions, were in this depression you experienced in your 20s. And I'm curious how the process of writing the book and kind of seeing that in the context of the working through has changed your understanding of that and the way that it fits into sort of the questions of meaning that you're putting together.
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, I think the title essay of the book is the place where that most saliently resolves itself or begins. I feel like, so in that piece, that the title essay is called Lost in Summerland, and I went to, my brother had a traumatic brain injury in his early 20s, and in the wake of that experience had professed to have all of these psychic phenomenon, which I regarded with overwhelming skepticism initially. And a few years ago, he pitched the idea of us going to this place called Lilydale, which is a home to 275 psychics and mediums who every summer open their gates to 22,000 tourists to do seances, drum circles, astrology walks, basically any iteration of New Ageism that you can possibly think of, you can check it out. And so we went there, and during the course of that experience, he and I reconnected and resuscitated our relationship, but also reckoned with some suicidal ideation that I'd experienced in the past, that I hadn't told anyone about, and he somehow knew. And so that was a piece in which a putatively zany narrative, this idea that one could have psychic phenomenon or intuitive capacities, or one could talk to the dead, these sorts of things. That piece became for me a moment in which I was willing to start suspending my disbelief again and seeing maybe the virtue of narrative, right? Because when the cognitive habits or intellectual calisthenics that I'd grown so used to in grad school and kind of turned in on myself, they reach a terminus, right? Like you become truly lost in a profound sense, and I was. And so learning to make a new acquaintance with narrative and becoming enchanted in some way or another again is, I hope that's the thematic logic of the book. By the end of the book, I kind of if the turning point is the essay where my brother go to Lilydale, I think by the end of the book, there's an account of marriage as a moment, as a kind of story, right? Like you're drawn into a story about being together with someone, and not that marriage is the only way by which a kind of perspectival change can happen like this, of course, but it was the moment at which I began to see a different way of conceptualizing narrative, a like kind of life story in a sense. And actually, I was just reading Stanley Cavell, Pursuits of Happiness. Have you read any Stanley Cavell, Rachel? He talks about his the screwball comedies of like the 30s and 40s, and so like Cary Grant and Katharine Hepburn, those movies. And at the beginning of those movies, there's a divorce or the threat of a divorce or separation. And by the end of the movie, the characters get remarried in some sense. And Cavell makes a rather provocative point, or he posits this idea that you know, the same cognitive swerves that are required of marriage are those that are the kind of same intellectual, emotional maneuvers that one has to adopt in a republic or being part of a democracy. And it's like a radically provocative idea, and I don't even know if I agree with it. But it struck me as kindred to what I was thinking about of how can one, in good faith, with all good skepticism, learn to develop and apprehend narratives that nourish you in basic ways, I guess.
Mm-hmm. In terms of the narratives of the book, we were talking a little bit earlier, and I was kind of maybe provocatively saying that the conspiracy theorist and the essayist have this kind of associative thinking in common, that it's about kind of making connections and how convincingly you can do that. And so I was kind of curious to hear you talk about the form of the book and whether you think, you know, it's being kind of marketed as a book of post-truth essays, whether you think that it is an artifact of a kind of post-truth world in addition to a report on a post-truth world.
Yeah, I mean, there's an extent to which I think the book is a fossil of this kind of epistemological crisis. My publisher would probably be annoyed with me by using the word fossil to describe my book as suggesting that it's already aged. It is a bright, shiny new record of our epistemological crisis.
Well, it will last through the centuries.
Thank you. Yeah. I mean, I think that the conspiratorial element. So the book, the essay in the collection that deals with this most directly is about my friend Luke, who was found in the Mississippi River when we were both 21, and around his death began to accrue all these sorts of conspiracy theories involving a roving group of serial killers known as the Smiley Face Killers. And two retired FBI investigators began to develop this theory because there were smiley face graffitis near where the bodies were found, bridge abutments, rail cars, dumpsters, all these things. And there's an extent to which I feel like, so in my grief, I kind of got swept up into following these conspiracies, even if I didn't necessarily subscribe to them. But just the utter absence of any kind of satisfying resolution to his death kind of nudged me toward stories, harebrained stories that were. It became clear to me that they were providing something to those who were most significantly bereaved by those deaths. And there's an extent to which I think, you know, the associative logic required by that and is not dissimilar from that of writing an essay. And and hunting for truth and meaning, right? And I think that maybe by the end of the book, I come to a place of acceptance of paradox or irresolution, like that things, that certain stories cannot resolve, they're kind of fundamentally irresolvable. I'm not a conspiracy theorist. I just want to make that clear and put that on the record.
Noted. You mentioned earlier that the disaster of City piece was sort of the moment when some of this all started to coalesce for you. And I wondered if you could just introduce that essay and kind of explain why you think that, because in a way that one is the most repertorial and kind of maybe even seems like doesn't, it takes you to a different place than a lot of the others. So I'm just curious to hear why that seemed like the linchpin.
Yeah, I am. So Disaster City, for those of you who haven't read that essay, it's a 52-acre training compound in College Station, Texas, where FEMA teams perform live simulations of basically every cataclysm one could possibly conjure. Train derailments, building collapses, pandemics, mass shootings, all the things that I have deep terror of as a person. And during the course of that essay, I enlisted as a victim volunteer. So someone who would don what they called moulage, which is fake blood, and they would like stick these impalements out of you, these metal impalements, and then they would bury these victim volunteers in the rubble, and FEMA would perform rescues, like truly jackhammering through cement, moving rubble, pulling up buildings, and extracting these people. I was buried like under, I don't know, even know how many feet of rubble, like 6 feet of rubble for like 5 hours. So that was particularly pleasant. Thank you for that, Rachel. 16.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was deep. It was very deep. It looked like a crypt. At a certain point, there may have been some tears. This was another piece.
You were definitely texting me saying, why did you send me here? So it was
I did. And I believe you said, don't let it crush your spirit. And I appreciated that. It was buoying, to be sure. Yes. But that was another piece in which there's a sort of zany premise. What I thought would just be kind of a zany piece or somewhat fun or interesting. What typically happens, as you know, is I do a lot of research up front. And what I find is that doing all that research up front really calibrates my thinking so that when I go on the reporting assignment, I kind of know what I'm looking at, or I have some sort of interpretive lens to be selective about the details or the experiences that I want to pursue. And during the course of doing the research, what I uncovered is that America's disaster preparedness is so bound up with certain narratives that tells itself about its threats, right? So in the 1970s, when FEMA got started, the most of the appropriations toward disaster preparedness or readiness were geared toward Cold War narratives, right? And staving off nuclear attacks from Russia. One of the more urgent and immediate effects and the more lasting financial consequences of disasters really were hurricanes, more everyday natural disasters, whose damage could have been mitigated by better building regulations, more sane zoning laws, more prudent ways of thinking about, you know, building on certain hazardous landscapes.
Okay, we'll see whether he comes back. If not, we'll have to have him sign out again and sign in. Apologies. thank you guys for sticking with us here.
I was trying to avoid jumping back in, but I'm going to jump back in just to see if we can tie things over. And this is unusual, but thank you. As Rachel said, thank you for your patience.
All right, here he is.
What the heck are you doing?
I don't know what's happening. I don't know. Okay. Wisconsin is too far. I don't know.
Well, thank you. And please continue. I'm going to duck out again.
Okay.
So
You were talking about the difference between disaster preparedness and disaster prevention, and how the U.S. has historically only sort of cleaned up in the aftermath and has not put. Yeah. So please go ahead.
Yes. Yeah. And so I guess being there and being within the rubble, and taking part, being actually embodied within the narrative of that this is what we do, right? This is the cultural logic by which we redress, or we think about, we're willing to suffer these catastrophic losses in the name of, you know, any number of things, because we're only going after disaster preparedness and not disaster prevention, which would require sacrifices politically, et cetera. But so for me, that just all the themes were so glaringly announced, right? I mean, talk about narrative breakdown, talk about the ways in which narratives are used to manipulate power structures or reinforce certain ideologies. And then in my own case too, it was a piece in which I was sort of exploring my greatest fears, right? And so making heads or tails of how best to understand that. So it really felt like a closing. It was the last piece I wrote for the book, but it felt like a closing parenthesis on some of those larger cultural arguments that I wanted to make.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's also one of the most repertorial pieces in the book. And I wanted to ask you a little bit about doing reported essay, this combination of observation and reflection, that I think, you know, essayists can have like quite a thick interpretive lens, and people in their essays can sometimes be sort of rhetorical symbols. And doing a kind of mix of that, being the reporter and the essayist, how you navigated what you owed to the people you interacted with, in terms of not only sort of slotting them into, and, you know, obviously some of your models, Didion and Wallace, you know, how you thought about what you were doing in relation to some of those earlier pieces.
Yeah, I mean, the first reported piece that I did was a piece called The Soldier in the Soil, which was about a group of anti-war veterans in central Wisconsin who started an organic farm and protest community, and who were trying to use farming as a way to mitigate their post-traumatic stress, but also build community and do outreach to the civilian population and tell their stories about what they'd seen in country and what they'd experienced in the wake of their service. And that was a piece in which I basically taught myself how to do this kind of work, right? Whereby I was trying to, I would use the preface, like I would do a lot of prefatory research, and this would kind of give me a lens. But then when I would actually go spend time with them, it almost was like the research was a way for me to clear the emotional space, that such that when I actually went on the reporting assignment, I could be present and actually see the person and experience what they were going through and understand why they would take up a narrative like they were, whether it be like the sort of putative relief that a men's retreat would offer, or whether it be the solace that, you know, a kind of new age or spiritualist in reading of death might offer. I do so much up front. I do so much research up front that by the time I go, it's like I want to forget that I'm almost doing that, I'm critically analyzing them. Like I want the frame to already be there, so I know what I'm looking for. And then when I see the person, I just want them to regard me as a person, and I want to be able to regard them as a person. Because I'm as a writer, I think I'm most interested in implicating myself and thinking about the ways in which I'm involved, right? That there's a reason why I went to this place or why I'm interacting with this person. And so many of my pieces involve me kind of becoming a character. And I think that's really it's not some sort of shtick. For me, it's a kind of ethic insofar as I want to kind of triangulate the reader, myself, and the subject all at the same time and kind of put us all forth, or basically put myself next to the subjects and put us up to the reader to say, okay, we're both here for scrutiny, right? Like, and I think in doing that, I don't know that I always succeed in doing that, but I think when it works well, I hope that there's a genuine emotional connection forged between the three of us, as it were. But I guess I've given up on doing a piece where I've given up on some pieces where I don't think that I can do that. Like, I don't think that I can implicate myself, or the personal element won't be legible, or that I don't have, you know, I mean, the other concern I have is that, you know, going into these kind of parachuting into these subcultures, one worries about being seen as touristic or, you know, as an interloper. And so all of that prefatory work is my way of like, okay, I think I have enough to ask good questions when I go, right? And the touristic thing, deactivating the touristic thing for me involves putting myself in the piece. Yeah.
In a minute, I'm going to invite Jennifer back to ask some audience questions, but I think probably there are some people who learned about you and your book from the piece you published in Harper's this month on TikTok. And so I just wanted to give you, as a last question, an opportunity to talk about, first of all, the reporting of that piece, but also in many ways it hits on very similar themes to those that are in the book. So how you think about, you know, your project going forward.
Yeah, I mean, so that piece involved me going to a collab house or a TikTok mansion in Los Angeles called Clubhouse, and spending time, most of my time, with a group of boys who are influencers and TikTok influencers who make anywhere from, you know, $10,000 per video to $60,000 per video. I met one 16-year-old girl who was making $500,000 a month just doing TikTok videos. Mm-hmm. And during the course of that experience, I got to know these people a little bit well. They made me part of their troupe. They put me in a TikTok video, which I believe Harper's used as a way to advertise the piece, which was hair raising for me. But yeah, I mean, this was another piece in which the putative subject turned into something else, and that some of the reflexes that these influencers had, this sort of comfort with blurring the lines between their virtual and visceral selves, the constantly posting content, using every occasion in their lives to make a YouTube video or make a TikTok or make an Instagram. There was a moment where I went to Target with some of the influencers, and one of the influencers was on a phone with a dog breeder wanting to adopt a French bulldog puppy, and she had this on speakerphone, and so I was hearing everything. And she was getting this dog flown into LAX in like 2 days, and it was like a $5,000 dog or something, I can't remember, very expensive. And at the end of the call, she turned to her manager and was like, "Oh my gosh, I can make a YouTube out of it." And that kind of logic, that kind of willingness to broadcast every blink and breath was really interesting to me. And it became the more time I spent there, it became clear to me that some of some of what I saw was giving them lots of anxiety, giving them a kind of, I would see pockets of this kind of weird sadness every once in a while show up in the influencers. At one point, one of the influencers said to me, you know, what if this all goes away, and what if your life is worth nothing? And this was roughly commensurate to some of the things that my college student, my university students would say to me during office hours, on Zoom chats. And so it struck me that these TikTok influencers and this impulse to monetize the self, or this impulse to use, to constantly broadcast oneself for likes and to kind of garner a following, that logic was permeating so many other facets of the culture and was contributing, at least in my students' case, to real sadness. And in my own case as well, I sort of saw similar impulses born of kind of economic necessity as a university professor, trying to be likable in order to secure tenure, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So yeah, the piece was, as I said to friends of mine, you know, you had me go to a men's retreat, you buried me under rubble, and you sent me to a collab house. And I think the collab house like affected me the most. I feel like that was
most harrowing.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we will maybe get to talk a little bit more about that during audience questions, but I'm going to invite Jennifer back so that she can moderate that. Thank you so much.
My goodness. What a fascinating conversation. Thank you both so much. And Rachel, thank you. You clearly get Barrett and knew what kind of things to ask him about. And Barrett, you just are so genuine and frank in sharing and responding. It's been really, really delightful. I'm sure our audience agrees. We do have some really good audience questions, as always. Our Mark Twain House audiences are renowned for posing good questions. So I'm going to launch into them. And I have one of my own as well. But Tara asks, and three other people have upvoted her question, in your fantastic piece in the June issue of Harper's, you tell a student there are books that offer, quote, equipment for living, unquote. Would you name a few of them? Thanks, Tara, for that good question.
Yeah, I absolutely would. I will name a couple things. I guess the thing that I'm so overwhelmed by this question, just because I find myself wanting to just provide a litany of books. So I'll just offer a few, and they're the most recent things that I've read that would kind of fall under this category. And that would be Stanley Cavell's The Senses of Walden, which is this book about Thoreau's Walden. But it's incredible. I just read it like 2 weekends ago, and it was clarifying on like 11 different levels. Also, Yi-Eun Lee's book, Dear Friend from My Life, I Write to You in Your Life, which came out, I wanna say a few years ago, but it's a series of connected essays about depression and suicidal ideation, among other things. Also about Kierkegaard's Either Or, which would probably be another book I would put under this rubric. But I also feel like there's a piece that was insufficiently celebrated this year by Aleph Batuman about the Zoom versions of Greek tragedies. It ran in The New Yorker, and I thought it was the most beautiful and challenging piece. And I'm not very much online, so I don't know whether it had the kind of seismic reaction that I thought it should, but those three things I keep finding myself thinking about, and they're things that I've been thinking about lately. So
thank you so much. And to the audience, remember that this is being recorded, and if you go to minute like 43, you can come back and jot down those titles. So thank you. That's awesome. I can't wait to look at them myself. Josh wants to know, he says, and somebody else agreed with him, it's clear that music and meter are important to Barrett's writing. Two questions. Rachel, how does that affect the editing process?
Oh my God.
And Barrett, are you? Wow, Josh, you clearly struck a chord here. Barrett, are you reading your work aloud and charting out your dactyls and trochees?
I'm going to let Barrett start with this.
I just was delighted watching you respond to that question, Rachel. I think about meter a lot, and I think every writer has some sort of entry point into language that entrances them, that makes them want to write sentences, right? And for me, the thing that ends up mattering a lot is cadence and meter, and sometimes to the detriment of the sentence.
Yes.
And Rachel is incredibly good at telling me and pointing out where it's not serving the piece. And that's why I think she laughed.
Yes, it's Barrett is, while he unfreezes, I will just give my answer to this question, which is Barrett thinks so, well, in his Disaster City piece, he talks about his OCD and how he thinks about it. And I think he thinks about rhythm so much, and not just on the sentence level. He really wants paragraphs to have a certain flow to them, often a velocity that's trying to carry the reader through an entire paragraph to land them at a certain place. And so, yes, we have a lot of conversations about whether that effect is, you know, having to balance that kind of against other things that are really important to the piece, like, does it make sense?
I don't like that. I wasn't here for the first part of your answer, so I'm very worried.
I mean, it's his. I think yes, Barrett's relationship with rhythm is the thing that gives his writing its joy. It's unique. It sounds so. I mean, that is my positive answer to this question. Is that I do think that rhythm and meter is that actually your question has kind of unlocked. Yeah, what is really special about Barrett's writing?
But you did acknowledge that sometimes the kind of adherence to, or the devotion to cadence and meter was to the detriment of the prose ultimately.
Oh yeah, definitely. And Rachel's the best editor on the planet. I'm really lucky to be writing for her. And I'm so grateful for her and Harper's for letting me write for them. I just feel really lucky. I mean, Harper's was for me when I was a young person thinking about writing and thinking about having a literary life. Harper's was and remains the magazine for me. And so I just, I'm just really lucky.
Well, I feel the same way, and so does Harper's.
Oh, I'm gonna clip that moment and post it somewhere. That was really nice. Are you willing to take a few more questions? Because our audience has some really good ones. Okay, this is kind of a follow-up, and I don't know if it was meant as a follow-up, but Michael and another of our audience members ask, how has Rachel's editorial style challenged you as a writer? And what has been special about your writer-editor relationship at Harper's? So kind of flipping that thing around a little bit.
Yeah, there are many different ways in which that's happened. I think even conceptualizing a piece, I think I've become better at thinking about what a piece can be. Like, what is a good topic for a piece? Rachel is unbelievably trenchant in locating a piece that is going to work. For me, like, she's good at isolating the kind of piece that I think I'm good at, that I excel at, which is so gratifying as a writer, right? Because you can get sent down the wrong alleyway so often. In terms of structure, it's I have a tendency to write long, and Rachel is so good at, like, surgically diagnosing how the piece can move around and what it can do. And then at the level of sentence, she's really good at understanding when I'm writing well and when I'm overdoing it. And yeah, there are like four people I trust with my writing, and Rachel is definitely one of them. So I think, but whether it's conceptually, structurally, or at the level of sentence, it's I feel like I've just gotten better and better as a result of having written for her and for Harper's.
Well, and I think you are wise to recognize how rare and wonderful that is, and special, because not everybody does have that, and so many writers struggle with their editors, and so that's a real gift, as you know. Now, here's Absolutely. A whole different kind of question, and I love this. Frank and a couple other people wanted to know. He says, I saw on Amazon that Lost in Summerland was number 40 in men's gender studies and number 49 in violence in society. Another person put a question up and that made me lose my place. And number 164 in cultural anthropology. If you could come up with, and this is a question for each of you, if you could come up with an Amazon category for the collection, what would it be called? Fantastic question, Frank. Thank you.
I mean, I kind of want to hear Rachel's answer to this question.
I can't think of anything serious. I would just say Me Barrett goes on road trips. Like I don't know, but I think that those three categories are all three of those make sense to me. I mean, I know that essays about contemporary masculinity was sort of an early conception of maybe what this collection was going to be, as you wrote. So.
Rachel, you're breaking up a tiny bit. Could you try leaning in a little more? Like we,
yes.
Thank you.
Is this better?
Yes, perfect.
Okay.
No.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
I think you were saying that they kind of all of those categories could be appropriate for the book, and yeah, I mean, I think that's right. I don't know what they would be called. I mean, I really feel drawn to the spirit of essays generally. I think essays is what they are, insofar as essay is an attempt. It's this struggle. It's this experiment in thought and language. And I think the pieces I'm most proud of in the book are the ones in which I feel like the formal, the essays take on, they kind of defy their putative conventions, like whatever supposed genre I'm supposed to be writing in, whether it's a reporting assignment, ends up becoming a personal essay. And if I'm writing a personal essay, it ends up becoming literary criticism. And if I'm writing literary criticism, it ends up becoming something else, if only because I'm trying to just put the, I'm always trying to, as I said, implicate myself, but always pushing the piece into some place where I don't know necessarily how I'm going to answer this. If only because I'm just suspicious of just like easy condemnations or easy resolution. So yeah, I think essay, I just like essays. Yeah.
Works for me. Thank you. Dr. Wesley B. Wants to know about your background. He cites, you know, religious background. Where did you do your undergrad and grad school? I would ask if you have a musical background. And he also wants to know, if you're willing to talk about it, what helped you get through your depression and suicidal ideation? And again, if you don't choose to talk about that, that's absolutely fine.
Oh, I went to undergrad at Loyola University Chicago, and I went to grad school at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and I do have a background in music. I was in a singing and dancing group called A Company of Kids, and we, between the ages of like 11 and 14 or something, we sang at like various festivals.
I love telling this story so much.
I know. it's so out of keeping with so much else. I was involved in that. I what was helpful for me in reckoning with depression and suicide were books. And these experiences, really. I mean, by neurochemical disposition, I'm the type of person who wants to stay at home and not be in the world, or to kind of, it's easy for me to withdraw. And so many of these pieces kind of nudge me out into the world, and they're incredibly taxing emotionally for me to go on these things. To hear these stories, to be with these people, to experience these things. And I guess in reckoning with how people came to find a meaning in their own lives and use narrative in their own lives, it was clarifying for me. Sort of the intellectual project became coincident with the emotional one that I began to see, particularly in the title essay, when my brother and I go on that trip. I began to see how all of my intellectual concerns were really rooted in some sort of emotional agitation. And so kind of solving one of those problems, namely the intellectual one, or becoming more comfortable, I think was useful in me kind of feeling marginally better about the other thing.
That's really helpful and really interesting. Thank you for sharing that. Now, have the two of you ever met in person?
No.
That just seems insane, because you clearly have a really good connection and a really good relationship, and it's nice to be privy to it, and to see that how easily you exchange ideas with one another. It's really, really been a privilege to spend the evening with you. I think that was pretty much all of our audience questions. I did conflate a few of them, and I hope that I didn't do an injustice to anybody. I will ask one more, because it just appeared. And because it's a very good one. Matt and another person want to know, it's rare to read truly laugh-out-loud long-form essays. Who or what writers have helped shape your humorous style? And I'm so glad that you asked that, Matt, because, of course, this is a program associated with the Mark Twain House, and Mark Twain was a great humorist. And so I think that's a really apt way to wind things up tonight. Can you talk about that?
Sure.
I want to say that I agree, because in all of what we've talked about tonight, we have not talked about how funny Barrett's writing is. And when you hear a lot of the subject matter, it can seem like, you know, that, and it is often like, this made me laugh out loud, also embarrassing. So,
yeah, no, thank you for that. I mean, Twain, obviously, Aleph Bautman, I think, is hysterical, particularly the Idiot. I just think that's an incredibly funny book. Gary Steingart, Laurie Moore, who is my professor in grad school, I think is one of the funniest people on the planet. And Wallace. I mean, all of the usual suspects, I would say, yeah.
Well, has either of you been to the Mark Twain House?
No, but I'm sure we would both love to come.
Well,
yes, definitely.
One of the things that I like to say is that the Mark Twain House is a writer's home and a home for writers. And having spoken with us tonight, you both are now officially members of the Mark Twain House Circle of Writers. And I hope that you both will come visit us, and we'll give you a great tour and take you behind the scenes. And it would be just so delightful to have both of you individually or together come visit us when it's safe and possible for you to do so.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Yes.
And thank you for sharing so openly and delightfully. It was a really great conversation, and look forward to continuing at another time.
Definitely. Thank you.
People, if you did not feel inclined to purchase this book before this conversation. I can't imagine that you don't want to now. So it looks like Jacques has, thank you, Jacques, for reposting the link. And please do take advantage of that offer. And thank you both so much again. And we will see you soon and have a great rest of your summer.
Thank you so much.
See you.
Good night, everybody. Bye-bye. Good night. And thanks to the audience for your great questions, as always.